Ontario's parliament fumbles by killing the right to repair bill, and a father battles his anti-vaxxer ex-wife. I'm Marco Perri. Welcome to the Perri Platform. Another day, another group of politicians who play themselves. Let's dive right into Ontario's parliament to look at the latest bill that they decided to kill today. It was the right to repair bill, which was designed to empower consumers. How would it do that? Well, it was going to force companies who sell electronic devices and other consumer products to provide customers with the tools and knowledge to repair gadgets themselves, instead of only having one option, which was to send it back to the manufacturer for a typically lengthy and expensive procedure. To illustrate the idea a little bit better, here's an example. If my screen gets chipped on my phone, according to the bill, Apple would allow for the resale of screen parts and provide instructions to me how to fix the issue myself. So theoretically, I could go on Amazon or to Walmart or to the convenience store, buy a replacement screen, which would be supposedly cheaper than having Apple replace it for me, go home, have Apple give me instructions on how to replace the screen, and I could do the operation myself. Of course, if I wanted to, I could still always go to Apple directly and get them to do it for me. In our current economic system, Apple pretty much has a monopoly on repairs. You can't just go to anyone to do the repair for you, or else you face consequences like your warranty being voided. It's pretty much treated like being illegal. And on top of that, the parts are hard to come by, and Apple purposely makes it extremely difficult for you to do any repairs you want by yourself. But back to that in a second. This bill, and the type of ruling that comes with it, would apply to every company, and they would give choices and allow for competition to enter the repair industry. Both good things for consumers. Of course, our tech overlords are not fond of good things for consumers, though. The bill was only set to be released for Ontario, but they were shaking in their boots about the notion of consumer-friendly laws rippling about globally. The vote failed, and the bill was killed due to heavy lobbying against legislation from major tech companies, including Apple. You can take that as the tech companies banding together to protect profits and screw over the consumers simultaneously. Two check marks for them. On a side note, I just want to mention that the principle of this really bothers me. I have a major issue with the way money can influence politics to this degree. The representatives, who we vote in, are meant to vote in the favor of us, not corporations. But I'm going to touch more on this point in just a second. First, let's talk about the repair situation. If you want to fix an issue yourself, or even get a third party to do it, it's often extremely difficult due to roadblocks the companies intentionally build. And even if you get past that, there are negative consequences, like I mentioned before, the voiding of your warranty that deter you from even going down this route in the first place. Each of these tech companies has established a monopoly of sorts. Apple is the only legit place to repair your Apple products, and because of this reliance and lack of options, they can inflate prices and lower quality to abysmal levels because you don't really have any other options. It's Apple or nothing. You can view it as a forced submission. The vote in Parliament wasn't even a vote to enact the law immediately. They weren't even at a stage where they could do that in the life cycle of the bill. Certain MPs were urging the others, their colleagues, to vote yes today to simply allow for another round of discussions and to further explore the topic. But it seemed like that was way too much to ask for, though. A resistance, largely reported to come from the Conservative Party, rejected the idea outright. One of the popular defenses for their movement to get rid of the bill was the fact that Ontario's Open for Business slogan was contradictory to this new bill. Khalid Rashid, a member of parliament, gave the following quote: "The bill would force companies to hand their codes and security stuff to average consumers." Now, obviously this guy is a moron who can't even grasp the concept of what's on the table. How likely is it he's a hollow politician acting as a corporate puppet? Quite high, I would say. This bill doesn't require any codes to be released, first of all. Where did he get that notion from? It's not like the bill was requesting all the tech giants to convert to open source platforms. And secondly, what the hell does he even mean by security stuff? Can you be more vague? And it just comes off that he has no idea what he's talking about. Let's be clear here. The bill was aimed at repair manuals, diagnostic tools, and parts. That's not even remotely close to the defense he's presented. Even the argument that this is not good for business is interesting. I'm not quite sure I can agree with that. What really is Apple's course of action here? It's not as if they hold all the cards. We actually do. Are they going to stop selling in Ontario because of this? I doubt that. Are they going to cut jobs? I doubt that. The bill actually might do the opposite, as they would theoretically need resources to deploy these manuals and diagnostic tools. Maybe some jobs would sprout out from that. And on top of that, if you take into consideration the fact that third-party repair stores will now be incentivized to legally do business, it might actually expand the amount of jobs available in Ontario. Sounds pretty good for business to me. Consumers still have to buy parts and whatnot. The list goes on and on. Then there's also the possibility that this school of thought, the consumer-first mentality, catches on in other places around the world and it equalizes the global playing field. EPSC, which is an industry group that advocates for tech companies, you can view them as a puppet that's controlled by Apple, Samsung, Panasonic, etc., made the additional claim that it was a public safety issue to even allow consumers to repair their own products. I can't even fully buy this argument. Consumers have been fixing their appliances for years. People repair their cars, which are far more complex and dangerous. If the EPSC is really telling me that consumers should be allowed to fix their cars but not their phone screens and batteries, then I don't really know where they're coming from. Oddly enough, one thing adding to any potential danger here is the design of these products, which, as I mentioned before, were made as intentional roadblocks. With my old Samsung phone, I'm talking like 5-6 years ago, I could change the internal battery out by simply sliding the back off and putting a new one in. It was simple. Now though, with Apple, the battery is sealed off and hidden deep within Narnia. I need like a SWAT team to even get close to it. That compounds the issue. It doesn't have to be like this. I don't need an Apple engineer to replace my battery. This is just the result of companies making things harder than it has to be to benefit them. There's also another key part of the bill that these companies seem to be missing. They are supposed to provide manuals and instructions for customers so they aren't acting without any prior knowledge. They're supposed to be informed on how to do the repairs safely. One of the ministers was asked if Apple contacted them in regard to the bill, and his answer was, "We heard from industry stakeholders about their concerns." In other words, yes, they heard about it, and yes, they were influenced by Apple. This whole debacle makes near zero sense to me. Consumers should have the ability to make repairs to the products they've bought and to the products that they own. It's their property. Now, let's touch on the point I made before about lobbying. It's a complicated topic because it comes in many forms and is technically not illegal. One way to lobby is through media representation, another is simply with money, corporations use it, unions use it, and the list goes on and on. Now, you may think it sounds like a bribe, what happened here, but technically, that wouldn't hold in a court of law because they make a distinction between bribery and lobbying. There is a very sly way to navigate that field. You can make a donation to someone, a politician's campaign, and then make a suggestion or simply voice your concerns to them. This is not a direct order or agreement to carry out an action. In legal terms, you can't establish a quid pro quo because a direct exchange isn't there per se. There's no evidence and you can't bind it together. It would be very different though if a company explicitly said, "Shut down this bill and here's $100. That would be bribery. I've seen bribery described more as a sale of power, while lobbying is considered an influence of political power. It is the extortion on one side, the demand, or simply the influence or giving ideas on the other side. I think it's all pretty shady. The bottom line here is politicians aren't here to be influenced directly or indirectly by corporate entities. It's not right. They represent the people, not companies. It's a completely backwards way to run our system. We're the ones who elected these people in the first place. They are here to serve us. In some way, you can consider them to be working for the people, our employees. It's really a betrayal of their public duty. Getting money out of politics is a controversial topic, though, because it has its pros and cons, like pretty much every other situation out here. One key argument for allowing lobbying and the funding of politicians is, for a politician who doesn't start off rich, it's hard to quit your job and finance a campaign without some corporate donations. Right now, the easiest way to finance yourself is getting money from corporations. And without an alternative, it would cap participation to those who are wealthy enough to take the risk. This would result in only rich people running for office because they'd be the only ones who can afford to campaign. You could maybe argue that that's how it is now anyways, but removing the money would compound the issue and make it 10 times worse. Now, lobbying itself wasn't envisioned to be like this. It was thought to be a way where entities could prevent governments from making bad decisions about things they knew nothing about. So, these tech giants were supposed to lobby if the government was about to do something that would destroy the tech industry, for example. But in this case, it's not like that. Clearly, the intent is just to preserve profits. It's unfortunate the bill was struck down. It made a lot of sense to me and to many other Canadians. I do hope that one day it is revisited with more honest politicians at the table. So enough about that. Let's jump into another legal battle here. Round two. This time we have a divorced father who is battling against his anti-vaxxer ex-wife. The article goes, Arnott Prestes has taken to the legal system to fight to vaccinate his children. He's divorced and his ex-wife is a hardcore anti-vaxxer. I'm wondering why they broke up. So they went through arbitration and a ruling was passed to uphold the ex-wife's wishes to keep her two sons unvaccinated. Now he's going to the Supreme Court to change this decree. First of all, how the hell can you order in favor of anti-vaxxing? It's almost comparable to passing a pseudo-death sentence. If those kids get ill, is the arbitrator going to take responsibility for this nonsense? The father argues that the arbitrator, his name was Herschel Fogelman, who I might add is a complete fool, based his ruling on pseudo-scientific evidence about the dangers of vaccination. Now, it makes sense. You have an anti-vaxxer apologist making rules in favor of that ideology. Really, the well-being of the child should be the paramount concern for all parties here, but it's plain to see that's been disregarded. Both of the boys here, the two sons, have already suffered whooping cough, something that is vaccinable and preventable. The father makes the case that he's uneasy, knowing his boys are at risk of contracting something like measles due to a lack of protection. A quote from the arbitrator really shows you how much of a moron we're dealing with here. Choosing not to vaccinate is not illegal, negligent, or immoral. It is a personal choice, and that's his quote. Well, he might have one of those things right. It's not illegal, although laws are changing rapidly. The other two things, though, he's dead wrong. It's 100% negligent and immoral. I'm shocked how we can't see that. Is it not negligent to put your children at unnecessary risk of contracting potentially fatal diseases? Is it not immoral to have your child become a catalyst for infection who could definitely kill other children who couldn't get vaccinated because they have medical reasons to not do it? This really is asinine stuff. This man shouldn't be in a position of power at all. And here's another amazing quote from him. To decide whether it was in the best interest of the two children. How the hell can you even make the case that this here is what was best? If I was the father in this case, I would have thrown this guy back to the dark ages so we could face the plague or something. You're an active force in the backwards thinking that is haunting our current civilization. One thing that I should have clarified from the start though, is that arbitrators have the same power as judges in these family law cases. It's a flawed system with derps like him running around. Here's the cherry on top of everything though. The arbitrator ordered Presti to pay his ex-wife's legal costs, which totaled over $34,000. Of that sum, it included an $11,000 fee that she paid to an American doctor who gave a case of anti-vaccination evidence, quote-unquote, that holds no water in the scientific community. He essentially came in, said some crap, convinced the arbitrator, collected his fee, and left. All expenses paid for by the husband. How ironic is that, really? Then on top of all of that, he still has to pay his own legal fees. Simply stated, this is unfair to the core. She probably searched the seven seas to find this anti-vaxxer doctor. Like, how isn't that a paradox? How can you be a doctor that doesn't believe or administer vaccines? Can I be a blind pilot? Or even better, maybe I'll be a health inspector who doesn't believe in germs. I'll just let all the restaurants run free and pollute their places because I think germs are a myth, based on no evidence whatsoever, aside from my faulty intuition. That's pretty much what he's done here. Keep in mind, all of this is happening while North America is facing some of the largest measles outbreaks since 1994. The US declared measles eliminated in 2000, but it's a shame those researchers didn't take into account idiocy would be at its highest levels right now, coming back and reviving past plagues. So this is all just too crazy. Here's my recommendation. Disbar the arbitrator. He has no place being in family courts. Strip the doctor who testified of his license. Get those kids vaccinated and have the ex-wife pay all the legal fees and a little bit on top to the husband for all the chaos that's happened here. People don't want to hear this, but family courts are obscenely biased towards the fathers in some instances. This here is just another drop in the bucket. The child is not always inherently better off with the mother. That may be the case most of the time, but mothers don't always know best, and in this situation, it's a clear example of that. Don't get me wrong though, having a mother is extremely important to a child, but when she's willing to put her two sons at risk of measles for no good reason whatsoever, it may not be the best way to go. The key here is to use logic and context. Take each of these cases on a case-by-case basis. This is really what the system was intended to do, but unfortunately, it has failed in this instance. The prevalence of anti-vaxxing is so bewildering to me. It's gotta stop, unless we want to revive some of the greatest horrors of human history. People are really quick to forget what it's done to past civilizations. That's unfortunate. Now, before we end the episode, I want to have a casual conversation. Haven't had one of those in quite a while, actually. Today, I want to talk about Game of Thrones, the Battle of Winterfell. If you haven't seen it yet, I must warn you, I'm probably going to spoil it. So now's a good time to just close the episode for the day and call it quits. But if you want to stick around for my commentary, it'll only be a couple minutes. And I have to vent to you because I was so disappointed by it. There was just so much wrong with the episode, in my opinion. First of all, well, this wasn't so crazy to me, but a lot of people didn't like the lighting. I must admit, I found it kind of dark at some points, but I gave them the benefit of the doubt for that. It was a creative decision, I guess, to really get you to feel that they were fighting in the middle of the night. It was hard to see anything, and it kind of increased the level of fear, so for that, I'll give them a pass. I had more issues with the plot of the story. That battle scene, the very beginning of it made no sense. Why would you send the Dothraki, your first line of defense on light cavalry, into the pitch darkness to approach the enemies by themselves? Obviously, they got slaughtered. Then everyone was surprised when they didn't come back. Zero sense. Next, what is Bran doing? He was literally playing Flappy Bird. He became a crow for the whole episode and did nothing meaningful. He just sat there. Theon died, and it seemed like he was about to die too. What was Bran's plan? Did he just go there willy-nilly? Then Arya has to teleport from the gates of heaven to do a knife trick and surprise the Night King with a stab to the gut. That was probably the most anticlimactic ending to a arch villain that I've seen in such a long time. I feel like we didn't really even get to know the Night King. Who was he? What's his backstory? Why did he seem so powerful, yet got slain by a simple stab from Arya? Now, I get she's an assassin, but look at the scenes. Arya had a drip of blood fall from her nose onto the ground, and the zombies got alerted. Now you're telling me she was able to maneuver past hundreds of them without being seen or heard, and then just leap 1,000 meters into the Night King's chest? It really made no sense, and this wasn't the ending befitting the Night King. But aside from all of that, I felt like the episode was very un-Game of Thrones. One of the main appeals of Game of Thrones was the fact that they were willing to kill off main characters without much of a second thought. In this episode, it didn't happen. I fully expected a lot of those key characters to die. They were getting mobbed by zombies, but somehow they were able to survive 20 minutes fighting 1,000 zombies to 1, and the only characters who die are Theon and that old guy who wanted to bang Daenerys. It really made no sense to me. So there's still 3 more episodes, and I hope they can turn it around because I was kind of caught off guard by that. Jon Snow didn't do much. He was running around getting chased by a dragon. He played himself and fell off a dragon. There wasn't really too much heroicness coming from him. Daenerys too, she landed her dragon in a field of zombies, and then she was surprised when it got mounted. Very little logical thinking here. And now it's Cersei's turn to fight Daenerys. Hopefully it makes a turn for the better, because that episode, I would give it like maybe a 7 out of 10. Not the standard 10 out of 10 that I gave to Game of Thrones on a week by week basis. Definitely not worth the build up, in my opinion. So that about does it for today. Thanks for joining me on the Perri platform. I'll see you soon.